Now, you're driving really, really fast, and all of a sudden you notice that the road has ended, there's a cliff. Now, to add to the drama movie style, every single person you know and care about is in that car, including the pet dog that your family just bought. Now, you want to save them, right? Now, the question is, you can't break the car and stop it before the cliff. That's what you did in 1D motion. But now you don't know if that's the best option. So you also want to think of one more, which is to accelerate and jump off the cliff. In other words, take off from the cliff and land on the other side where there's a cliff slightly below, as you can see. Now, you're at the important juncture where you have to decide which of the two options to take, to stop the car, try and stop the car, or to go as fast as possible and jump off the cliff. Now, what's the minimum speed you need to be able to land safely on the other side? The answer to these and more life-altering questions is what lies at the end of this video for you. Now, the crux to solving this problem or any such problem is to realize what? How many projectile problems are there? Only one, right? Because the fundamental method you use is the same. Then you might ask, but I've seen many, many types of problems of projectile. Yeah? Anytime a good question comes in a competitive exam, it becomes a new subtopic in many of the books. So that when you look at the chapter, it looks as if there are so many different things to learn. But even though in all of those, right, using the same fundamental idea. A projectile is thrown from an inclined plane was asked once, it's a separate subtopic. Thrown from a height, what's the maximum range? Separate subtopic. Even though you're doing the same thing. But why would they do that? If a good question in this year's exam doesn't become subtopic in the next year's book, how will the book keep getting thicker and thicker year after year? And if the book doesn't keep getting thicker and thicker, how can I convince you that this is important enough to be afraid enough to study? And if I can't do that, how will I motivate you to prepare? With fear. Now what we are going to do though, is look at all those problems, different types of them, but keeping in mind that they're all the same problem, disguised to look differently. So let's begin. Now since you've come this far with us, I know that whenever you hear that a body has been thrown at an angle theta with a velocity u, the first step that you'll think of is to resolve that into its vertical and horizontal components. That's going to be natural and easy for you. And then you know it's a 2D motion problem with acceleration in one direction and no acceleration in the other. And I've never sounded more repetitive in my life, right? We've told this n number of times. So then, every single problem is going to fall under this bracket. So what is the x coordinate at a time t? The horizontal velocity into time because it's uniform motion. So x equals u cos theta into t. What about the vertical? Because there is an acceleration, it's going to be u sin theta into t minus half gt squared. Great. This gives you the position of x and y at any point in time t, which means you're kind of done. You know the position at all points in time. I want you to observe something here, right? Between these two otherwise independent motions, there's only one common variable. What is that? It's the time, which means the only thing connecting these two independent motions is the fact that they're happening simultaneously, this variable called time. Now in math, you'll learn something called the parametric form of an equation. Now it sounds like a big thing. I want to show you how that's exactly what we're doing here. So what have we done here? We have represented the x coordinate and the y coordinate of this body's path using a third variable called time. So instead of going directly from y to x or x to y, we're going through this bridge called time. Now whenever we do this, when you write x equals u cos theta t and y equals something, both in terms of some third variable called t, this is called the parametric form, and that t over there is called the parameter on which this equation depends upon. Now you might ask, should I always treat them this way? Can I sometimes remove this bridge and go directly from y to x? The answer is yes. And how do you do that? When you have two equations and you want to get rid of one variable, it's called eliminating that variable, right? How do you do that? Substitute for that variable from one equation into the other, and you're done. Which equation will you choose? The first one, because it's simpler, yeah? So substitute for t from the first equation with x into the one with y, and what you get will look like this. Observe that this has only y and x, does not have time in it. So it's a direct connection between y and x, which means that for every point in x, you can start plotting what the y values are. And if you do that, this is how it will look. So this is the path that a body will take if it had been thrown on the surface of the earth. And now that you have this path, let's see how we can connect this to what we already know. So let's take a random point and mark the horizontal and vertical velocities. And now you know as you run through time, the vertical velocity is going to keep decreasing, the horizontal is going to remain constant, right? So the resultant is pointing along the tangent. And this makes sense because as you go through time, the curve is getting flatter and flatter, right? And finally, when it reaches the highest point, what happens? The vertical velocity is zero. And all that remains is the horizontal velocity. So as you can see, the curve is also perfectly flat over there. And now, then when you continue, the vertical velocity begins to start increasing in the negative direction. So which means the curve is going to get steeper and steeper in the downward direction because the horizontal is still constant. Now with all this, you would have already inferred that there is some kind of symmetry here. The vertical decreases, becomes zero, and then increases in the negative direction, always remaining symmetric across this one line. Now what I mean by that is, if I had launched at a particular speed at an angle positive theta with the x-axis, then when it lands back with the same speed, but making an angle negative theta with the positive x-axis. And even if I draw any other horizontal line, the velocity will point such that over here it has a positive value of theta and here the exact same negative value, and the speeds also will be the same. Now this path describes the motion of any body that has an acceleration along only one axis. In this case it's the y. If it had been the x, you can imagine it's going to be that way. Now this curve over here, right, has a name. Just like a curve like this, right, is called a circle, this curve is called a parabola. Now that you know that this curve has a name called parabola, realize that you don't know anything much more about it, right? You just know the name. So if you had to forget one thing, it's okay to forget this name, that it's called a parabola, it's not that important. But what is important is what we have done all this while to reach where we are now. All the playing with the balls to understand and get an intuition for what happens to a ball thrown near the surface. That's what's important. It's okay to forget this name. And even more importantly, you will very rarely treat a projectile in this form, looking at it as a parabola. How will you look at it? As two separate motions. And even if you really want to solve it using the parabolic form itself, in some rare case, you can go there from the parametric form with x and y separately by substituting 40 from one equation to the other. So with all this in mind, let's start solving the so-called cases of projectile problems, but keeping in mind that they're all the same problem.